Welcome to another Conversations with Otara. Today I have with me Rukshan Jayavardhana, conservationist and archaeologist. Thank you, Rukshan, for being here today.
Thank you.
I wanted to first find out from you what inspired your interest in archaeology and irrigation, because I know you are an irrigation expert as well.
Archaeology, actually, I was more inspired by the natural world from childhood, but when I went to university, I took a couple of courses in human evolution, and that inspired me to study anthropology, and then kind of it was a natural transition to specialize as an archaeologist. As far as ancient irrigation goes, I was working in Anuradhapura now probably almost 35 years ago. And though it was an excavation I was involved in, all around me was ancient irrigation, both in reuse, like tanks that had been restored, and many canals and other irrigation elements like ancient sluices that were in abandonment. And I also realized that they were poorly studied, and only a former surveyor general called Brohier had written about them in a technical sense.
Right.
And before that, there was a British irrigation engineer or a civil engineer called Parker who had written something about ancient irrigation. But together, if you read both people's writings on ancient irrigation, you still didn't get a good understanding of the ancient system. So
right.
I thought I will specialize in that area.
So Sri Lanka is, was well known and as being one of the foremost countries to on irrigation, and it was many other countries also followed our methods. What were some of the key things that were of such great importance in ancient irrigation?
I think Sri Lanka's, ancient Sri Lanka's main contribution to irrigation technology is something called the Visokotua sluice, or it's also called the valve pit sluice. It is, it acts like a surge chamber in modern sluices, where the water that comes out of a reservoir, in our case we call them tanks, the pressure is dealt with through the column of water rising vertically in this chamber, so that it doesn't, you know, excess pressures are not going to go through the sluice tunnel at rates that can destabilize or destroy that tunnel or endanger the embankment.
Right.
So, the gates that come into the sluice chamber or the Visokotua and the gates that go out of the Visokotua were controlled in a manner to make sure that the water pressures stayed in a state of equilibrium where damage to the sluice itself could be avoided. So, this is a technological invention or innovation. And Sri Lanka is the earliest examples of that kind of sluice come from Sri Lanka, and
right.
the most sophisticated Visokotua type sluices also come from Sri Lanka. Once again, you know, I can talk about things like stone anicuts or barrage dams, which also are some early examples, but technologically speaking, the sluice that Sri Lanka seemed to have invented is the most advanced of its kind.
Right.
And the key to the success of the sluice was it could be put into a very small tank with the sluice chamber having just a meter square dimension with maybe 2 meters of depth to upscale to many times that size, so that you can build these sluices really large and have really large tunnels to take the water out of tanks,
right.
So that you can't, you to build a massive irrigation reservoir is a much easier process than to work out the methodology to get that water out of that tank without destroying that embankment. So that is what the Visokotras Loose does.
So what has, it's obviously what happened then, from which we were the pioneers, and what's happening now is different. What are the key differences, and what would you think is good or bad about what we're doing today?
Firstly, I think we have a premise that if we work on a premise that if ancient irrigation managed to cultivate much of the dry zone areas, even the areas today that are under forest cover, then we can somehow repeat that process and we can have the same kind of agricultural plenitude that ancient Sri Lanka had. But something that we seem to ignore or pay little attention to is that ancient Sri Lankans up to the end of the Polonnaruwa period and beyond, actually to Yapahu and Dambadeniya, had an intact catchment in the mountainous areas, that is above about 2000 meters, sorry, maybe above 1500 meters or say 4000 feet, the forest cover of the mountains was intact, and this formed the catchment for all the rivers that flow out of the highlands in a radial pattern. And it is these rivers they tapped for the, for all the ancient irrigation works and all the tanks, reservoirs, canals. So today, look at the picture. We have tea, rubber and coconut, especially tea and rubber in the mountains. And even the highest mountains have kind of a, don't have an intact catchment. There are a few patches of montane forest, and that is actually inadequate to trap the rainfall and for it to be used in a kind of sustained manner through the dry season in the lowlands.
Because, I mean, whatever dams and waterways you build, what you need is the rain. So I think over the last 2 years, I think we've seen absolute turmoil in our environment. We've seen two floods, two landslides, a severe drought, and now we're on the, what we say is the second drought, but I don't quite think the first one actually left. So we're building all these mega dams and spending billions, but people are still struggling with no water in a lot of areas. So why is that, and why has that changed, what is this big, great change we're seeing?
Well, we are very poor custodians of our natural forest cover, especially the catchments of rivers. We build dams across rivers. We try to utilize that water for many purposes. One is irrigation for agriculture, and the other is actually to generate hydroelectricity. But we pay poor attention to the catchments of these river systems. And there is a lot of illegal settlements, actual deforestation with a view to, you know, benefiting from the timber. There is also siltation of upper reservoirs in the upper reaches of the rivers by agriculture or people cultivating illegally when the waters recede during the dry season. The reservoir bed is cultivated, then the siltation process increases. This affects the hydro capacity of the hydroelectric turbines. It also creates some direct impacts where sometimes, you know, just not just silt but stones and other coarse material going into these systems. But river reservations, stream reservations, reservoir reservations or catchment forests are all protected legally through statutes, but practically on the ground, governments don't take the correct measures to protect them because it's often what I say, they just play politics. Local politicians decide that anybody within their electorate can, you know, whatever they want to do, they protect them, they want to please them, they do an illegal settlement, they try to justify it and make it official and make it kind of regularize it. Mm. But all these actions cause the depletion of our remaining catchment and cause a lot of downstream problems, weather problems, the increased proneness to landslides and massive flooding during the rains. I mean, the rains may remain the same, but the flooding potential due to siltation, due to denudation of forests and the rapid runoff that is created by these things enhance the natural catastrophes that we face.
And of course, we are now at a time when there's global warming, and Sri Lanka, of course, global warming as such may have a small impact on Sri Lanka, but what we are doing, I feel, is contributing to excessive impact from this global warming that is happening, because we are not protecting what we have. I mean, do you believe that if we ensure that we protect our forests, protect all our natural heritage to a certain extent, that we will be able to counter this impact of global warming that we're seeing happening?
I think certainly we can be a country that we are considered a carbon neutral country, but we continue to destroy our forest cover at a fairly rapid rate. Mm. In fact, we have one of the highest rates of forest loss in Asia. So we are a relatively small country. We are just 65,000 square kilometers, and it doesn't take a genius to figure out that we will push our forest cover below that minimum acceptable level if we haven't already gone there. By being unable to protect the forest cover, natural forest cover we have, and to conserve what we have, because that has an impact on the daily lives of people. Apart from catastrophes, the agricultural self-sufficiency, the ability to cultivate in downstream areas all depends on how much forest cover we can protect, especially in catchments. We do contribute. We are a net contributor to global warming as well. So we can't be complacent and think that what's happening here is because of things that are happening in faraway places, in deforestation in Indonesia or in places like Africa or South America or the Amazon. We are also doing things to add to this global picture, which is worsening by every passing year.
Mm. So, I mean, what this is obviously, it is not pointing fingers at any particular government, or it is because it's been happening over the years, a consistent system where the system is run, where the environment is not really considered. Of late, it used to be obviously considered very, very of great importance with the kings and during the king's time, but something changed after that. What are the key things that need to happen fast if we are to attempt to reverse this huge adversity, as I see it, that's happening with the drought and with so many environmental impacts that we are seeing of late? For me, it's like a wake-up call from nature to wake up and listen to what's happening and to try to reverse, to fix it. And what are the key things that that can be done and should be done?
Well, existing laws that apply to conservation forests, catchment forests, stream and river reservations, whether it be under the irrigation department or whether it is under other departments that are concerned with land, or whether under the jurisdiction of the forest department or the wildlife department. Quite apart from the wildlife role of the wildlife department lands, they have another environmental role that is larger than just the wildlife itself. So all those laws and bylaws should be enforced very strictly for the collective good. And when governments at some point, you know, we lost our priorities. In the past, I think even after independence, we had good laws to protect catchments, and those were the times that some of these laws were put into place. But perhaps because there was still maybe 50% forest cover, authorities were complacent, thinking that we could still lose a certain amount of forest cover and not pay an adverse price. But what has happened over time and through successive governments is the most critical types of forest cover are equally under threat. There are projects that are put into areas that are strict natural reserves. Mini hydros do a lot of destruction, and they are justified saying it's renewable energy. But we have to look at all this in the balance. What is the most critical, what are the most critical parts of our environment? Do we need to generate electricity, a tiny percentage from projects that are destructive to the fundamental long-term viability of this island? So these are things that need to be put in place. Existing laws have to be enforced, and long-term plans must take into account conservation. Conservation
for
of forests.
For the benefit of all.
Benefit of all, yes. It's not for a five-year election cycle. You're not doing it just because you want to be re-elected. Because at the end of the day, this is our home. It's a common home to everybody who lives here. And this has to be a sustainable place that people can live their lives without the danger that is posed from a severely or critically damaged environment.
I think, I mean, even though some of us don't see it, but a lot of people are suffering immensely with the drought now and in the past as well. Past meaning just the last 7-8 months ago also, and now it's happening now as well. So there are some mega dams that have happened. So how come that that is to supply water to a larger area of Sri Lanka and a greater area, but it doesn't seem to be happening? And why is that?
Yeah, I think we are still trying to deal with, projected. Well, if you look at annual rainfall in an ideal year, and then look at how much you can do with that rainfall before it flows to the sea, then maybe many of these projects can be justified on the basis that we have the water to utilize for agriculture and for all other purposes that human beings need water for. But since we don't have adequate catchments to utilize that rainfall, and much of it goes as runoff and rapidly goes to the sea, and there's a lot of loss of not just the forest cover but topsoil. But we still look at ideal figures and try to extrapolate and put in projects which utilize a limiting or a diminishing resource. And this diminishing resource, that is water that is available in the rivers, is our responsibility. We have made our rivers run drier in the dry season, so the drought is inevitable, because there is a period where, especially in the dry zone, there is a long period where there is no rain. But if one looks back 50 years, if one can look back 100 years, and certainly someone who is trained in archaeology can look back a couple of thousand years, the river flows would have been completely different. If you could extrapolate backwards, then you will see why they were so successful with irrigation agriculture and we are so unsuccessful. So I think we need to bite the bullet, realize the reality of what we are doing and how we are diminishing this resource, because I think we are losing or running out of options now.
Okay, thank you, Rukshan. Thank you for speaking to me today.
Sri Lanka is a country that has rich natural resources for us to survive, both animal and people, for the years ahead. yet over the last so many years, so much of our environment has been destroyed that we are starting to see a lot of adverse effects on our water resources, and which you see a lot now with drought and lack of rain and various things like that, which are causing serious harm and damage to not only the environment, but many people are suffering as well. Sri Lanka is an island, and all our water sources are for us. It's not divided by other countries, it doesn't supply other countries, whereas in places like China and other countries and some other countries, the waterways actually flow across borders. So Sri Lanka doesn't have that, but we have done very little to protect this very, very important resource. And I think we are now at a tipping point where if we don't do something now, each and every one of us will suffer tremendously in the years ahead. And it is up to each one of us to act, to realize that now is a time where we all have to get together to make a difference, to protect our water source for the years ahead.